This week on New to You, we talk about Ray Bradbury's short story, The Veldt, and Poltergeist III.
Hey everybody, welcome to the New to You show. This week, we are joined by a new guest host, Giaco.
Giaco!
Hi, guys.
Hi, Giaco. Hi, welcome.
Thanks for having me. This is great.
How do we know Giaco, John?
We met Giaco through our local friendly game store, mm-hmm. where he is one of the employees there.
Yeah.
But he's also, and this is gets to our topic, which we'll get to in a second, a writer for Fear.
I am a writer for fearnet.com. Yes. I do a weekly horror comic article and a weekly horror board game article.
Very cool.
Sweet.
There are enough horror board games to do a weekly thing?
At first I didn't think so, but I'm stretching it out, so yeah. For sure. Yeah.
Have you sort of reached back as well to
that's the thing, that's what's
like
gonna
Fury
give
of
us
Dracula and...
Yeah, we're gonna look at Fury of Dracula. I'm even going back and trying to get together some old stuff from eBay that I'm getting, like old Addams Family games from the 60s
cool.
and stuff
the
like that.
The Green Ghost is like
the
a
Green
big
Ghost,
chase
that's
game.
What we're looking for, yeah, definitely.
Cool. So, are all the zombie games included in horror?
The zombie games are definitely included. I'd sort of do a broad catch-all for horror. You know, it could be thriller or
could be
horror.
Clue if you think about
could
it.
Could
right?
be. Somebody dies, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Or if somebody put dies. On, like one of those Star Trek hosts of murder.
Exactly. Yeah.
I don't know that. What is that?
There are these play sets like How to Host a Murder, which would be sort of you throw a dinner party and there's sort of
a
rough
a board
story.
Game?
It's sort of a.
It was an
game.
Experience oh, that got yeah. big in the 90s.
So it was sort of a board game, but it was really like you're going to have a dinner party and here's the roles you're going to hand out and here's the narrative you're going to tell in this dinner party. Someone's going to die and someone did it at the dinner party and it's like the guest's job to figure it out.
Star Trek.
A dinner party, but there's one of the box sets they put out was a specifically themed towards doing a Star Trek dinner murder party.
This all sounds kind of like LARPing.
So it's sort of, it's that insidious, like
you
getting
to drink blue milk. Oh no, that's Star Wars.
you have to have
Romulan ale.
Yeah.
Oh man.
You have to have a broken down race barrier and religion.
Yeah.
Good.
And just live in this utopian society for a short period of time.
You have to invite Whoopi Goldberg.
Yeah. That's what makes it horrifying and scary and adds the fright.
Whoopi.
Race relations.
Since we're all here talking about this, what's new to you this week, Holt?
New to me this week is I went to Comic-Con New York this past weekend, or I think so, yeah.
Yep.
And I try to go once a year on a professional pass since we're in the job of animation. But I got to see Sergeant Slaughter and the Million Dollar Man there in their own booths.
Lee Majors?
No, the wrestler, the Million Dollar Man.
Ted DiBiase?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow, cool.
So they were both... Sergeant Slaughter looks
the same.
I heard Hacksaw
Jim Duggan was there, too.
Really? I didn't see him.
Somebody told me he was signing 2x4s, which made me very jealous.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sergeant Slaughter, you could get his G.I. Joe signed. And he was wearing his uniform, and he had a G.I. Joe badge right there.
So
it was
cool.
Pretty cool. But yeah. Yeah. It was a good one. What about you, Mary? What was new to you this week?
Well... I also went to New York Comic Con, but I won't talk about that because you just talked about that. I read the book Divergent, which is, it's kind of like being marketed as the new Hunger Games. It's a trilogy. The third one's about to come out. It's a post-apocalyptic young adult story, first person, present tense, 16-year-old girl. Hmm. So a lot like the Hunger Games.
What's the catch? Like, what's the main...
She's in, you know, far future. You don't really know how the world got to be the way it is, but everybody gets divided into certain factions based on their personality when they're very young. They don't fight each other like in the Hunger Games, but
there's some territorial.
Some issues come up, and you know, there's maybe going to be some revolutionary things happening. So,
but there aren't like attacking robots or radioactive dinosaurs or zombies or...
No, not yet. Not that I know of. I only read the first one.
No one turns into a wolf monster.
So it's pretty much just like social structure.
But there's simulations in their heads, so a lot of crazy things can happen in the simulations. But it's fun. I wasn't super crazy about it, but I'll give the next one a go. A lot of people didn't really like the second two Hunger Games books, which I totally understand, even though I like them. So I'll maybe the series gets better instead of getting worse like the Hunger Games.
It gets better.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Trust me.
Giaco, what was new?
I've been listening to a new album by the band Yuck called Glow and Behold, which is really good. It's sort of indie, shoegazy, kind of, but it has a movement to it, sort of a more up-tempo than that.
Cool.
But this album's really weird because it has like, it sounds like a million different bands in one album. Like, it sounds a little bit like Girls at times and a little bit like My Bloody Valentine, but also a little bit like Apples in Stereo sometimes. Oh, okay. So it's this really wide swath of like moods to the album.
It's just spelled Y-U-C-K.
Just Y-U-C-K.
Cool.
Awesome. What turned you on to that album?
I was really into this band Parquet Courts. And someone told me, if you like that, you'd really like Yuck. And they don't really have anything to do with each other, but the person was totally right. So
they nailed it.
Yeah, totally.
Well, when you find that person, we'll put them on the show because they're apparently good at what we're trying to do.
So Keith, what about you? What was new to you this past week?
Well, I'm not exactly sure I'm signing off on it yet, but I started watching this show, Sleepy Hollow.
I heard about that.
I think it's on, this is maybe the third episode, maybe four. It's okay. The thing that I will say about it is, it's trying to combine an awful lot of things. There's a lot of, like, religious stuff and ghost stuff and witch stuff, and it all happens in Sleepy Hollow, New York. But...
Tarrytown.
Without saying too much about it, there's a guy who's been... he was cursed during the Revolutionary War, and boom, he wakes back up again. And the guy who plays him really pulls it off. And that is not an easy task. The main actor, well, there are two main characters. The main male guy, he really impressed me.
Is it modern? Is that
Is it set in present time?
Yeah, it's set today, yeah. And Orlando Jones from Mad TV and Evolution, and he's generally considered a comedic performer. He's got a really serious, like, I'm the hard-ass FBI agent kind of thing, and he does it really well, too. I was like, I mean, it's not easy to overcome those, preconceptions. You know, we think of him as, oh, he's the funny guy, but he's able to pull it off, so.
Awesome.
The acting in the show is good so far, so I'm giving it a few more watchings to...
Cool.
If it doesn't go far off the rails, I'm going to go ahead and get behind it.
Cool.
But I'm tentative right now.
So Sleepy Hollow somewhat segs into talking about our topic this week, mm-hmm. which is scary.
Spooky.
Spooky stuff.
Terrifying.
Frightening. Mm-hmm. So scary, I mean, as you get older, your fears, I think, become more, I don't know, maybe like either
fear
practical or existential, yeah. right? And then, but when you're younger, you sort of, you may have more ethereal or ephemeral fears and that are, fantastic, as well as some like societal social fears.
Well, I think even as jaded adults, we're still susceptible to the good old fright every now and then, the boo
of the jump
out of the,
the startled.
Which is, and it's easy to do that. It's not always easy to do that right consistently. Mm. So, mm-hmm. So there are a few good things out there that I think do that well.
So within our roster here, we've got some stories and some movies. And one thing I kind of want to talk about, we can save this for both sort of subjects or whatever, is which, those are sort of, there are many different traditions. We talked about scary stories to tell in the dark in an earlier episode, but there are oral traditions for sort of fear stories and scary tales. And, some are, old wives' tales, and some are, have a tradition that's born out of probably some sort of real super, like a superstition or a real event.
Some tall tale or myth that's been passed down.
But so it's interesting now that we're sort of in a more scientific age. We've come out of the Enlightenment or whatever, and there's a certain level of skepticism that's out there. What we manufacture to scare ourselves is pretty interesting, and we can kind of talk about that with these range of media we're going to.
Yeah.
So what are we, which one are we talking about first?
Well, let's move into the first pick.
I don't know.
Well, then.
I just want you to look at it is all, and call a psychologist in to look at it.
Well, what would a psychologist want with the nursery?
You know very well what he'd want.
His wife paused in the middle of the kitchen and watched the stove busily humming to itself, making supper for four.
It's just that the nursery is different now than it was.
All right, let's have a look.
They walked down the hall of their soundproofed happy life home, which had cost them $30,000 installed. This house which clothed and fed and rocked them to sleep and played and sang and was good to them. Their approach sensitized a switch somewhere, and the nursery light flicked on when they came within 10 feet of it. Similarly, behind them in the halls, lights went on and off as they left them behind with a soft automaticity.
Well, said George Hadley.
They stood on the thatched floor of the nursery. It was 40 feet across by 40 feet long and 30 feet high. It had cost half again as much as the rest of the house, but nothing's too good for our children, George had said. The nursery was silent. It was as empty as a jungle glade at hot high noon. The walls were blank and two-dimensional. Now, as George and Lydia Hadley stood in the center of the room, the walls began to purr and recede into crystalline distance, it seemed, and presently an African Veldt appeared in three dimensions on all sides, in color reproduced to the final pebble and bit of straw. The ceiling above them became a deep sky with a hot yellow sun.
So my pick this week is The Veldt, a story by Ray Bradbury, originally released in Saturday Evening Post in 1950, published under the title The World the Children Made. So this story, I read it in school probably back when sixth grade, seventh grade, when I was pretty young. And then I read it again in a collection in the Illustrated Man anthology. And I think, you know, of course I saw it in a couple of the later remakes and stuff, but the gist of the story is that you have a family in a near future or this, you know, futuristic house that cooks for them, cleans for them, washes them, ties their shoes. Basically, it's a living womb that just does everything for them. And the kind of heart of the house for the children is this nursery that reacts to the children's psychology and is sort of like a holodeck that becomes what they want it to become, and they can entertain their fantasies. It's a tool for learning, a tool for reading the psychology of the children and help develop it. And it's supposed to like react psychoactively to their mind space and how they are.
Their mood and desires.
Yeah. And so what you have are these parents who are becoming more and more unsettled by they aren't part of the nursery so much. They're more unsettled even more by the sort of emptiness of their life.
Lack of control.
Right. Like they aren't finding solace in the heart in this nursery. They're out, you know, they're just doing their work or leading their lives, but they have too much time on their hands. The guy's smoking more, they can't sleep. They feel sort of like those menial tasks that grounded them psychologically have been stripped away. And then their children are also becoming more alien as they rely on the house. So also, another thing to note is that the children's names are Peter and Wendy, which is a tie-in to the Peter Pan,
Never Land
sort of children
lost
in time. And, it's the scary part. And the reason why it's called the Veldt is because this nursery, every time the parents have been going into it, has been stuck in this African veldt, this just swath of dry, hot, oppressive, scary land with vultures going overhead, a watering hole nearby, and in the near distance, lions eating something that a fresh kill that they can't quite make out. And every time they leave the room, the lions are closer to them and about to get them. And, you know, I'll let you guys figure out if we should spoil this, but there's a psychological element to it. You kind of know what's coming pretty early on.
I think it's okay to spoil. I mean, most of it is about the mood and stuff anyway. And you know, it's from the 50s.
So I guess the thing is the parents try to unplug the house.
It's told like from their point of view. It's not really told from the point of view of the kids.
Right.
The house.
Right. So the parents try to unplug the house and unplug their lives from the dependency on it. And the kids have already sort of gone around the bend and have already sort of turned against the parents and are turning the house against the parents. And the parents are also weak and turn the house back on one last time. And through the whole time, every time they've entered, their disquiet has increased and increased as the lion veldt imagery has become more and more aggressive. And eventually, you know, they're help from an outside source who's a psychologist, a child psychologist who knows the room and is helping them relate what the children are seeing. He's like, you guys have to unplug. You need to get out. I'm going to help you do that. Unplug this stuff. I'll be back in an hour. Pack your stuff. We're going to go. And so they unplug everything, blah, blah, blah. The kids are like, please, please, one last time, blah, blah, blah. And so the kids then lure the parents into the nursery where they're eaten by lions. And you sort of end with this psychologist guy sitting having a picnic in the veldt with the children, being like, where are your parents? And the lion's like watching him licking its lips kind of thing. And
licking its chops.
And that's the end.
So was the idea that because you, the parents scream when the lions jump on them, and they say that they realize that that's why all those other screams that they had heard during prior visits to the nursery sounded familiar. So the parents scream when the lions are about to pounce and finally eat them, and they say that they realize, oh, that's why all those other screams that we heard in prior visits sounded familiar. So it was the idea that the kids were always sort of imagining that the lions were eating them?
I think it was somewhat self-fulfilling.
I think the house was preparing the kids for that.
Right. Yeah. The kids had just fixated on and built in the structure of, we're going to kill our parents. We're going to kill our parents. It's inevitable.
Think the kids did. I think the house is protecting itself like Hal.
The thing is, it's reacting to the psychology of the people in it. And it's saying the children are the ones who, like, I'm the parents of the children. So I'm protecting the children by getting rid of the parents. And the children are saying, we want this thing. We're going to get rid of our parents. And the parents are getting more and more uneasy. And so all those, I think everything combined, the psycho reaction of the house feeding the children what they want, the children's desires to get rid of their parents, get them out of the way, and the parents' own unease and their own sort of blindness to what their minds are telling them, that they're going to die in this room, are playing out over and over again.
Yeah, and it mentions the one part that I actually really liked about the book. They mentioned that the little boy in particular gets really surly and really mad after he's been denied a rocket ship ride to New York. And for months after that, like, he was just getting like more and more like agitated and mad and short with them and short tempered. So to me, it read like it's leading up to this, like they just hate their parents. They hate their parents. And that I read it as that they were imagining their parents' death every day when they went to play. That's like how they played, was imagining that their parents were getting eaten by lions.
That's why they keep coming back to it.
It's fun, yeah.
So, Mary, had you read this story before?
No, I was completely new to this. In fact, I didn't even know what the word Veldt meant.
Yeah, me either.
Now you know.
Yeah.
Well, funny enough, just today I was sitting in a diner, and they were Jeopardy was on, and Veldt was an answer to one of the question to one of the things. Yeah.
And you could have gotten it right.
Yep. It was the clues were the category was words that start with V, and it was in South Africa they call large tracts of land and farmland this.
Cool.
What is a Veldt? Yeah.
Nice.
Just today, coincidentally.
So, Giaco, had you read this story before?
No, I'd never read this before. This was definitely a fun new find for me. I really enjoyed it. One thing I really liked was sort of the way that they, the way that he does offhanded, references to the future. The way that you would know, like, oh, they got sucked up.
He wouldn't dwell in it. He doesn't dwell on it, but he gives you little hints.
He's like, they get sucked up the air tube, and he doesn't explain how the air tube works, but you figure, well, it's a future hassle. He'll get. Yeah. Sucked up a tube.
There are a few moments there
pneumatics,
where
the
children come off the helicopter still smelling like ozone from the helicopter ride. Their eyes like peppermint candies. Their cheeks like peppermint candies. Their eyes like azure marbles or whatever. Like these weird descriptive sort of little moments. And the room and the pressure of the room I think is very well illustrated and
But I wish I don't. Described. I don't know if it's the kind of story where he should explain it, but I don't understand how it happened, how the lions actually become real and eat them.
Well, I imagine it's like a holodeck or like room.
They kind of describe it as like it's these flat walls and everything's happening behind the flat walls. But then the lions.
But then he's able to pick up his own wallet that's covered in blood.
Right.
So it must create. I got the sense that it just creates.
And that's the thing, too. Like, you look at, like, they're sitting at the table and watching inside the table as their food is prepared. And it's like things are just materialized, like the ketchup. Oh, we forgot the ketchup. What? There it is.
So do you think it was a holodeck the whole time and he just didn't understand how it worked? He just thought everything was
fake? I think they're kind of saying, like you guys are saying, that there are fail-safes that are mechanical in nature, but perhaps the house.
Masked within hologram.
Right. Either the children, which was hinted at,
Peter is like a whiz at engineering for a 10-year-old or something.
Or again, the psychology of the house is such. Or it's suggestion and the parents, you know, it's that sort of like mystical crossover.
If you die
moment.
In the Matrix,
you
die in real life.
You die in real life. So they, you know, it was all imagery and they simply are gone. Who knows? Maybe they just ran away. And they're crazy.
It reminds me of some Twilight Zone episodes. What's the Twilight Zone episode where the kids jump in the pool and they swim to the old lady's house? They want to get away from their parents in a divorce.
Oh, yeah. No, I don't remember that one.
I don't know that one.
Yeah, well, it's a good one. It's a good one.
Had you read this before, Keith?
No. I'm a fan of Ray Bradbury's, but I never read the Painted Man anthology.
No, the Illustrated Man.
Illustrated anthology. Man. I got to look into that.
When did you... first read it? Sorry, did you say?
In middle school.
Was it an assignment, or was it just a library book?
It was an assignment.
Huh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But, I don't know. For some reason, we read a lot of Bradbury. Yeah, 451.
Well, I mean, because he had a lot of Bradbury. I mean, he produced
But we read,
stuff.
Like, Something Wicked, Fahrenheit 451, this short story.
His writing is so approachable. I mean, it's just really... you know, devourable. You read it, you can read it really quickly, but it's still got a lot in it. You know, it's not fluff, but it's just really approachable.
Yeah. It's definitely open handed, sort of like open palmed. Like, this is the story. Here it is. Come and enjoy it.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going to dwell on a lot of details, but I'm going to give you enough to make it work. And the language is just flowy enough so that it works too. He's a master.
We'll get into the heavy stuff in a second. There have been adaptations of this. There was an Illustrated Man movie that was sort of like a collection of short stories. That's
kind of
like Amazing
Cat
Adventures
movie.
The Black Cat. But it wasn't very good. And there have been a few other versions. It was in a Russian collection of stories. That's like one of the first like Russian horror movies is sort of in that collection. There was a music video because there's like a Dead Mal 5 song or whatever that was animated in that sort of that game Limbo. It's in that sort of style.
It's based on the story?
It's like a reference to, and it's called The World the Children Made or whatever. called Earth's the Veldt, and the lyrics are all about that, and sort of these sinister little silhouette children running around a bloody Veldt kind of thing. But I kind of wanted to open this bit up. So did you find it scary?
I think scary? I always find the concept of murderous children unsettling.
Children of the corn kind of thing.
Yeah, I think that's a that's a theme. What was that
the
movie?
The Bad Seed.
Yeah, The Bad Seed.
Valley of the what was the one too with the all the little blonde haired
kids.
The
cuckoos?
No, the
They're it's like the Village of the Damned.
Village of the Damned.
That's
that one.
All the children are cuckoos. They've been this group has been replaced by aliens. Yeah. So it's like cuckoos will kick the other eggs out of the nest. So these aliens have sort of replaced, or this entity or whatever has replaced the village's children with these blonde psychokinetic power alien babies, like changelings. And the parents are raising them because they love them, but sort of they're not right. It's the Village of the Damned. So
yeah,
it's a good movie.
Yeah. I think that, it's hard for me to say it's scary and that like, I don't really get scared by stories or movies anymore, even if they have scary things. I'm more like scared by being on a roller coaster or being in a haunted house. But I think this has all the elements that the theme of being in sort of this cozy situation. These people seem well off, and then, you know, there's something sinister and wrong, being eaten alive by animals.
By holographic animals.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, I felt it was less scary and more creepy, like a Twilight Zone. You know, I love the old Twilight Zones, and I guess when I was a kid, they seemed scary. But for the most part, I kind of just feel like they just kind of put you at unease a little more than they are scary. You know, this certainly feels very Twilight Zone-y,
right,
in that it's, you know, it's moody and you know, at the end, there's the big, big kind of reveal.
Right.
But I don't hardly ever get scared of things I'm reading, though. Mm. I don't know if I've ever been reading something and been frightened.
But it was suspenseful, and I guess I sort of equate that as the equivalent, I guess.
Right.
You know, like page turner. I mean, it's very short. So it's only
There are definitely stops built in, sort of like moments of like they shut the door on the scary thing and take a breath, but it's still there. The pressure has still not subsided. Like they haven't dealt with the issue. Like they just kind of clamped a lid on it. And I think that in this story kind of builds and builds and builds.
I really like that style. I feel like that's sort of not a modern style at all of storytelling and scary storytelling. The idea that you would build up pressure and then not capitalize on it is sort of unheard of in today's horror and the way we tell scary stories today. So it was really refreshing to read that again and sort of feel this pressure, and then stop. It's okay. It'll be okay. And then pressure. And it sort of undoes itself a little bit, but in a way that makes it more palpable as it rises.
Yeah, I never thought of it that way, but in a way it's like... it's like a lot of action movies in that there's some, you know, like a Bourne movie. There's big chase, big action scene. Okay, now they got to regroup, get a little bit of the mystery part out, get a little talking, maybe a little smooching, and then boom, more action. You know what I mean? It is something we are used to, but I didn't actually put it together until you stated it like that. That the book kind of had that feel too.
Yeah. I think it creates a sense of inevitability with this story, and you have, but I like what kind of, one of the things that I kind of find frightening and what I like in a suspense sort of movie, like in U-Turn or like a hard-boiled sort of like noir, is you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. At a certain point, you made the decision, and any decision you make that at this point is just going to probably get you in deeper, or, you know, or the character will just continue to make like, not bad decisions, but a decision that is more reactive and emotional, and it just sinks them it's just flailing in this quicksand kind of thing.
Yeah, but some of those I don't really care for, like the Simple Plan movie. You know,
see, that's I love that kind of stuff. Where it's just like you can't. There's no escape.
Yeah, I know. It's like soul crushing.
Yeah, I mean that's. I think that's what in a book kind of situation I enjoy that, and my takeaway is usually thinking about the moment and kind of playing it over and over.
At what point did they cross the line?
And in this story, it's sort of, there's a few outs that these guys have. The first in is that they bought the house in the first place. And you kind of come to realize that it's inevitable, that these guys are unwilling to, like, they've turned a blind eye to a lot of stuff, and they're children to some degree in and of themselves, and they want to be pampered and, like, have someone take care of their problems for them. They just give in to their children and let them do what they want, really, and let the house kind of do what it wants.
Yeah, but I think that's unfortunate, because, you know, it's apparent that these parents aren't just, you know, checked out parents. They care about their kids. You know what I mean? I mean, it's like, yeah, I hired a nanny, but I didn't expect the nanny to, you know, turn my kids into mass murderers. You know what I mean?
It's also vice versa too. I mean, they hired a nanny at just the same way they bought a dishwasher and a shoe tire.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. It's like, whatever, our children are just one more thing that takes up our time. Raising them psychologically is something that we just don't want to deal with. So we don't want to cook our dinner. We don't want to take a shower. We don't want to brush our teeth. The house will do it all for us. We paid the money.
Yeah.
That's why we're wealthy or whatever, so we can do these things. And that's, I think, what comes back around on these guys, is that their situation that they put themselves in.
Do you think Bradbury built that in as a kind of a cautionary thing?
I think he was aware. I mean, I think there's this is a good story on a few levels, in that you have sort of fear of technology in terms of, like, what happens when you replace basic functions and grounding like rituals with, it's like butterfly effect kind of stuff. What happens when you strip away all this stuff? Exactly. But it's, again, at a certain point, when are you messing with nature versus nurture or whatever? When are you, by not properly just, like, nurturing your kids like you should, creating more problems by trying to find a scientific solution or whatever? Like, there's some things where maybe you shouldn't.
And that's why I'm going to homeschool my kids.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought the kids were really interesting in this, though. The more I think about it, actually, even just sitting here, like, children that are completely unmoored from the basic tenets of what you have to do to be alive, the tying your shoes, the brushing your teeth, the taking a bath. Kids that don't have to do that are going to grow up weird, or are going to be weird. And they are really painted like, I mean, it is Ray Bradbury, but I mean, they really are painted like two small ghosts or two small aliens that sort of float through this house and are just weird and antagonistic and demanding. It's really, really interesting.
Well, my question there is, so we have computers and we have a generation, I mean, maybe the generation a little older than ours has kids now who are on the computer and doing things that they probably don't understand. And you have, like, cyberbullying, and you have this whole world that Lifetime makes movies about, like, your daughter got stalked or whatever. But there's this sort of alien technological alienation that is there with or without technology to some degree between generations of parent and children. But I wonder if there's a certain amount of that, you know, experiences that you had as a child, and then the next generation will not have to have, you know, like, kids don't have to learn, like, kids don't take penmanship type classes anymore.
Kids don't have to learn how to kill a chicken anymore.
Right. Well, like, they don't teach cursive in schools now.
Yeah, well, I mean, you got to be careful of that, because we're now reaching the age where we're like, oh, the next generation's going to blow everything up. They're all terrible. I mean, we've been the victims of it.
That's what I'm saying.
I grew up being labeled Generation X, and, you know, it's that same thing. It's just like, everyone's going to think the world's going to end when they're done.
Well, that's never
going to change.
That's my next point, is just because they're alien doesn't mean that they're they're thinking in the wrong way. They're just thinking differently than you. In this story, they're differently, and their mores and their social norms are so alien that it, you know, the parents sort of fall in the pit of that, and society won't bear
I think more of the cautionary tale part of this is like, don't spoil your kids.
Yeah.
you got to put your foot down and say no.
Yeah, I sort of took it as like the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory kids, you know? Of course, we don't see as much of these kids as we do of those kids, but just these sort of sinister little
Veruca
salt brats.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's an interesting...
What do you do when your kid is a brat?
Feed your parents to a lion.
That would be a way better ending to, the Charlie and Chocolate Factory.
Charlie?
You
passed.
Get nothing. You get nothing.
Yes, Wonka gets eaten by lions.
It's an interesting point that you make, though, about the sort of that where they're at now. The kids having an alien view, because it's a. It seems to me the book seems to be a real jump in technology. You don't get the sense like someday, theoretically, our descendants will have what they have. You know, their shoes.
Yeah, it's not a new feat. It's not a new near future kind of thing.
But this is like, it feels like, well, it's, it feels like the year is like 1950 and it's like, we just moved out of our rancher into this like hyper home.
I think it's sort of that, like that popular science articles or life, like the house of the future or that you go to Disney World and it's like, in the future, agriculture will be run by robots. And that sort of like 1950s. Positive, like we're already advancing this far. Like just 40 years ago, everyone had a horse. Nobody has a horse today. And just imagine in another 40 years.
Just imagine, Mom, vacuuming that floor with atomic power.
Yeah,
this is gonna happen in the future.
You'll have more time to hang out with the girls.
But we do have some of that stuff. I mean, home automation stuff is getting pretty big now.
Yeah, especially with, like, computerized homes and things.
Nest, and you guys have that thing that answers the doorbell for you or something, like an app. And
well, no, we have the thing where if the buzz is, it goes to our cell phone.
Okay, gotcha. Yeah. But
so, but that's, I mean, that's a good point too, though. You have definitely, like, the woman's issue is not, she's not working.
Right.
And she's not, it's not like her expectations are work. Her day is not full of doing dishes and cleaning stuff, and that is really bothering her.
So that gives me the impression that at some point in her life, that's her day did comprise of doing these daily chores.
Well, also, you got to imagine, this is a future imagined before reality TV. Because if reality TV happened, they'd just watch it all the time, and they wouldn't care what's happening to their kids.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Pawn Stars is on, y'all.
Yeah. So, would you guys recommend someone read this? I mean, it's a pretty quick
read. Absolutely. Yeah, it's so short, too. It's like, what?
All right. Any last thoughts? We're going to round table this. Any last thoughts on the Veldt, Mary?
Thumbs up.
All right. Giaco, any last thoughts?
Lions.
But I think as a last thought, I want to say take it easy on the kids, because I think they're being manipulated just as much as everyone else. And as well, you know, bringing back to the Wendy and Peter thing, it's kind of saying like, what kind of a kid would be able to go off and live on their own in some never never land, you know?
Right.
So I think it's not, the kids aren't evil necessarily.
Yeah, I don't think they're evil. I think again, it's a matter, like, they're neglected. It's this sort of, and that's a big point.
Like Park Slope kids.
They're raised by a machine, and a machine doesn't have feelings, Keith.
Nope.
Now they don't have feelings.
Nope. How could they have?
Yeah, so Ray Bradbury's The Veldt, published in the Saturday Evening Post in 1950. You can find it online through
Project
Gutenberg.
Which is
like
awesome. I'd love to imagine like a Norman Rockwell illustration.
Lions tearing apart the
family. Exactly.
Yeah, there's got to be some good fan art of this, I bet.
Yeah. So, so check it out. I hope it was maybe not new. Well, it's definitely not new, but hopefully it was new to you.
Outside the lion's room. Guess who's back in town?
This week on the show, we're talking about scary stuff or spooky stuff or terrifying stuff. And there are lots of things that we could have talked about. I think in the late 90s there came a rash of movies that I really think pushed the spooky movie a little further. But I figured a lot of people have already seen them. I mean, I just remember being horrified by The Ring and by what was the Ju-on.
Oh yeah, that's sort of like a huge movement of Japanese
coming to
horror,
yeah,
right.
And just like these terrifying visuals. But as we often do on this show, we end up going back to our own like formative times, and the scariest movie I've ever seen in my life is Poltergeist. I was just a young kid, and that movie literally scarred me for life. There are certain things in there that still spook me out. But again, Poltergeist, it's a Spielberg movie. Everyone's seen it. So I figure, well, let me just move it up a couple notches. And I went to Poltergeist 3, which I still think is a very scary movie, especially I saw it. I was older than when Poltergeist came out. But I still find the visuals in it very frightening. If you remember Poltergeist, it's about a haunted ghost house that really is just wanting to take a little girl. That's pretty much it. And that's what happens in part two. The ghost gets a personification in what's his name? Some old man Kane or
Kane.
Reverend Kane. And he's and so in the third movie, it's pretty funny because the parents are kind of like, get rid of Carol Ann. We cannot handle this in another place. So they send her off to Chicago to basically get some treatment because she needs it because the poor girl's been traumatized by ghosts since she's 4 years old. And so now it's Poltergeist, but in a high-rise building, like a modern, super... super kind of industrial kind of movie, and I think over the years, not everything holds up very well in that movie, but I still think that there's a lot of frightening things in the original Poltergeist, and in this I feel like some of the most frightening things is that they're dealing with a foe that there kind of aren't rules with this
right.
foe, and they can use anything around you against you in a way, and just that psychologically I think is very frightening. This movie in particular, reflections is it, mirrors, reflections, reflections on water surfaces. There are so many things that that the evil force uses as their arsenal. And just as a normal person, when you're walking around, it's late and you're kind of getting a little spooky because you're alone or you hear something, reflections are so creepy.
Right.
You accidentally catch a reflection in the window because there are lights on outside, but it's dark outside. There are lots of these things that are very spooky without there also being a ghost in there.
Well, that's like the, what's the sort of classic, sleepover spooky thing where you go in the bed, in the bathroom, turn off the lights and you do,
Bloody Mary.
Oh, Bloody Mary. Yeah. That's
and
right.
And what's happening, you say it like, what, 3 times or 13
Don't
times.
Don't say
or whatever.
It.
Well, the idea is you're not in a light-proof box. There's light leaking out under the door, whatever. So your eyes are slowly adjusting and getting night clear, and you're starting to see your own reflection, but it's distorted by the low-light environment, and your own imagination playing this game pumps you up into seeing something in the mirror.
Yeah.
And, there's your Bloody Mary spookiness.
Yeah, and I think this movie really... capitalizes on that. I think it does really well. And there are some just really creepy visuals in this movie, as in the other Poltergeists as well. That just the idea of the little girl with the old man head, you know, like with the old man's head, and it's a little girl's body. That's so creepy. And just running around, just catching a, and what they do so well is just catch a glimpse of it. You know, as a filmmaker, is their trick in filmmaking is just give you just a flash of something. Did, what was it that I saw? You know, I just love it. I think they did very well. And the idea of the, there's a certain point in the movie when there's just a little water on the surface of the parking garage, you know, and they're walking by, and it's suddenly, it's not just I mean, it still looks like a little water splashed on a thing, but it's a deep, like, hole of water, and something like pulls them in. I just love it. I mean, there's just so many little things like that, that just, when you walk late at night in a fluorescently lit parking garage and see that water, it just still, you know, gives you a little creepy.
What's kind of interesting too is that for being sort of a spooky gotcha movie, they worked in a pretty well lit, brightly lit environment almost the entire time. Because one,
which is one of the things that's really, I mean, they're playing with the idea of like spooky house. Well, it's a modern house. It's not your old, you know, old abandoned house on the thing. It can still be just as scary.
Right.
Go ahead. Sorry to interrupt.
There are very few moments that were in the dark in this movie.
Yeah, that's really interesting too, that you're not going to hear like the creaking footsteps going down the hallway, because there better not be creaking footsteps.
Right.
It's a brand new building.
So right.
That's really interesting.
And I like that it's not, it's a brand new building, so everything goes haywire, you know, like a Maximum Overdrive kind of thing, where it's the electronics
go.
Yeah,
you.
This is still the ghostiness, but in a different setting. And you know, I just think it was a great end to the series, and it's got, and everybody knows there's all this myth behind it, and you know, the curse of Poltergeist and all this stuff. But you guys might have a little bit more information on that than me. I just think that it's still a very spooky movie. I mean, I just watched it. I think it still holds up. I mean, there's some dated stuff in there, but you know, what horror movie sequel doesn't have that, you know? But I'm going to open it up to the floor. What did you think, Giaco?
I really, really enjoyed this. I've actually never seen this one. I've seen Poltergeist 1 and 2, and for some reason this sort of got away from me. I was extremely, extremely impressed with this movie. And going to something you were saying, they're so subtle. For this being a third in a series, to have these little things, the little, you know, you see the reflection of Old Man Kane or Reverend Kane in like tiny little, like split second scenes, that is like, that's very rare for the third of a series. Normally by then things start to get a little sort of heavy handed or ham fisted.
You think by the third movie it's going to get a little cheesy go ahead.
Sorry. Yeah. But everything that they did, and the special effects are just amazing, and the practical effects, the makeup, the when people get hurt, or there's a scene where one, like the love interest falls down into the water with them, and he's the first to sort of pop back up, and he's like a brick of ice, like he's covered in ice, and it's like, what a scene. Really, really
hot. Scott.
Yeah.
Hot Scott is all ice cold.
Well, I like too that they play with the idea of there being kind of reflective versions of these people, not to give too much away, but there's a kind of a netherworld that they get kind of pulled in and out of, and you don't know who's who and all this stuff.
Right.
It's
just possession. Are they like weird shadow versions of themselves?
Right.
Yeah. I think the big thing for me was maybe it's sort of a, like a Doyle sort of way that it came about, as opposed to like, there's this theory of sort of storytelling, like Watsonian versus Doylean, or like Doylist, where you have,
Wait. Doylist is a word?
Yeah. Well, because the idea is like Sherlock Holmes, right?
Okay. Oh, Arthur Conan Doyle.
Sherlock Conan Doyle. So like in Sherlock Holmes, you have certain things that happen and are sort of told to you and are part of the narrative because Dr. Watson is telling the story. And that sort of
one step removed.
And it's plot development because the story is going this way. It's sort of how the story is going to flow. Then there are sort of meta, like Doyleist or Doylean or whatever aspects where Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was
I think we should just call it Doily.
Or Doily. Yeah. Exactly. So there are these Doily moments like he's just like, I'm tired of writing Sherlock Holmes. He dies in Rocking Buck Falls.
Right.
You know, and he just writes his character dead. And that's it. And that's the reason for his character taking that step is not a Watsonian sort of how the story should develop sort of thing based on how the story's told. It's just straight. If you see it in TV more or movies more where the production quality says we can only do this or we can't get into this house. So that dictates how the story's going to be told. It's not on a beach anymore. It's in the jungle.
Okay.
That sort of thing.
Or like a star of a TV show, like, gets a DUI and suddenly their character gets killed off.
Right. That's a Doylean story.
Well, Downton Abbey is the perfect example of this.
Not to spoil too much.
I don't need to worry
much,
about yeah. spoiling, do I?
Yeah, well, let's not get into it.
Or in Lost, Boone, the actor, said something spoily on a talk show and then they killed the actor off. They killed him off.
Yeah. You see it in a lot of TV, you see it in a lot of movies where, you know, and in this movie, you have the young actress who was 12 and when they were shooting this in 1988 was when it was released. She was
Heather O'Rourke.
She had some like bowel issues and died in a very tragic circumstance at a very young age. And this was near the completion of the film. And so what I kind of wonder in watching this is, like you said, there's the structure is very loose. The rules are not very clear on like what
none of the rules are clear on any of the poltergeists.
Right. But it's very surreal.
Yeah.
And a very like odd, like, well, what happened to those characters? Who knows? Like,
yeah, the end, it ends in a very like, mm-hmm. who knows?
And I found like an alt, someone had posted, this was the alternate supposed real ending of Poltergeist. Really? And it's as surreal and weird as well. Like, it's not an answer. Right. It's just other weirdness. So what I wonder is, you know, how much of this is The Crow, where we have to body double and try to fill in the holes and try to tell the story.
Mm-hmm. I think she died after filming.
Yeah, I think the filming was all finished.
Okay, because yeah. there's some stuff like they were hiding her face
at the very
end. The very end yeah. for the ending. Like, mm-hmm. I think they reshot the ending after she had passed away. So,
which would make sense that they would have an alternate ending because, you know, then she died before the movie came out. So they didn't maybe want to perpetuate some kind of myth about it or something. So maybe that's why they had to reshoot some stuff at the end.
Right. And I mean, if there was like anything in the original ending that has her being harmed in any way, you just can't put that out if she just passed away.
So. But
it was a shame because that kid in the first Poltergeist is so good.
She is really so young too. She was five.
Even in this movie, I find her to be such a like bolt of electricity in the movie. Yeah. Just even though they're like kind of corny one-liners, it's just like she is just on fire the whole time.
Yeah, it really colored my viewing of the film knowing that she died, just seeing her life in peril in the movie. And then there's the whole theme of nobody loves me because I'm trouble all the time. Yeah. And I'm like, no, people love you.
I mean, it's a shame when you have like a six-year-old who is reading 90-page scripts, you know, who is a, you know, she's a young child actress who could have made it. And, you know,
yeah, and it sounds too like she was maybe misdiagnosed.
That's pretty sad.
Yeah, it's super.
But she's not the only actor in this. Tom Skerritt is also in this movie. Mm-hmm. And Laura Flynn Boyle. He's good. I like Tom Skerritt in this.
I love Tom Skerritt in everything.
Yeah. Sitting there smoking in the like.
In the art gallery.
In the art gallery. Really weird. This is something.
That's just the 80s.
Yeah. Something I want to bring up is that, and they didn't really, the other kind of rules of this thing, they didn't not only not explain the supernatural, they didn't really, they kind of created the world and just kind of let a lot of it go, I felt. Like we live in this building that has a shopping mall in the bottom and an art gallery in the middle and a bunch of houses and a pool and it's everything in one big building. But we never really go back to the shopping mall. Right. We built this whole playground and we just kind of stick to about four sets as the pieces. Mm-hmm. And that was interesting to me.
You don't go to the mall every day.
But it was just sort of this weird, like.
Especially when you got ghosts. And I think for like part of a great part of the movie. They're looking for the little girl.
Right. So I guess it was like just a little weird. Like, why build a super building and populate it with all this wacky stuff? Basically, Gremlins 2 kind of did a better job of building the super building playground and letting the monsters go wild.
Gremlins 2 was following like 6 or 8 different characters. You know what I mean? It wasn't. In fact, the building was kind of one of the characters.
Well, that's and I actually kind of starting out was like, this is a Gremlins 2 style sequel where you have a complete change from suburbia to an urban setting. You have like fresh, clean, crisp kind of stuff, and they're giving you all these elements like elevators and mirrors and, you know, what are those, like window washing, raising, lowering the things.
Platform, yeah.
I mean, those are your Chekhov guns that you're like laying around. Somebody's going to use those to no good at some point. And like the Chekhov elevator for me was just when there's a point where their elevator gets stuck between two floors and they like prize the door open and they're trying to climb through. And I was like, don't
yeah,
do it.
Yeah, that was really cringy for me too. That was hard. I don't like elevators.
That they didn't do it. Yeah,
yeah. That was my. I was the same boat. It's again. It's like a loaded gun is right there.
But even if that had happened, it's like you said. The rules are so weird. Would she like? If she had gotten cut in half, maybe she still would have been alive at the end because the Laura Flynn Boyle character is taken through whatever the watery portal is and comes back. It comes back and it's revealed that she's actually
a mirror version.
Yeah, zombie. Yeah, Scott. Yeah, and
she's
zombie
a bad.
Laura.
She's a baddie, but then she ends up. She's okay. And I don't.
Is she? I don't know.
Right.
If you haven't seen this movie yet and you feel like you can't follow along, that's natural. That's a natural feeling, I think, with this movie. But it's to good effect and not to sort of an annoying effect that some horror movies are just like, man, I don't know what's going on, but they're scaring me and whatever. But this is like, you know, things seem out of place and it totally, I bought it the whole time.
My favorite part of being like, huh? Was when Tom Skerritt and his wife, I forget her name, Nancy Allen maybe?
Yeah, they, I think that's it.
They think they're in the clear. They think they've escaped what's happened. And they've just seen, for the first time in their lives probably, all this crazy supernatural stuff.
Like frozen hell
and then,
world.
And then it just kind of stops and they're like, oh, we're okay, let's go upstairs and make love because we're like horny newlyweds. And then so they get in the elevator, and then the elevator.
Well, I don't know, man.
But...
get the juices flowing, that like adrenaline.
Yeah, it was funny though. I like kind of liked it. It added to the sort of creepiness factor of the whole.
Yeah.
I thought he was. There are these weird moments they give you where like Tom Skerritt goes to boop Heather O'Rourke's nose, and his new wife who. Is not the mother of Laura Flynn Boyle and is just sort of the aunt-in-law of Heather O'Rourke, kind of gives this weird look like, oh no, he's doing it again with another child. And I was like, wait, what am I seeing here? Like it's all these weird signals are given. And then there's this conversation at the end where she's just like, screw this little girl.
Yeah.
We don't need this shit. Right. Let's get out of here. And then they turn, like, she's just turning on a dime to, like, no, but I love you. I love you, Carolyn. I love you.
Right. Well, you know, humans stay there. They're wavering.
She's mercurial.
Well, it did seem like one of the rules was that if you say you don't love Carolyn, that they'll
let you go.
Like, they didn't. No, they didn't like that, right? Because every time she said it,
they love
Carolyn. It would attack.
Yeah.
And then in the end, she was saying, no, I do love you. And
I don't know.
That. It was like love saves all or something. I don't know.
Yeah, I really like though that when her character says like that's her answer, like right after they get through this big trial and sort of tribulation, and the husband's like, you know, what are we gonna do? And the newlywed wife says, well, we're gonna get rid of the kid. I feel like that was actually a very honest moment,
and very honest
screenwriting. That like, no, she is the reason all this bad stuff is happening to us. Get her out of here.
Yeah.
Like, it's not the right thing to say, but it's a very honest moment in the movie to me.
Yeah, it's gutsy, a little gutsy, you know. It reminds me that it kind of harkens back to the story, the Veldt story, in that it's kind of the house or this force you know, kind of trying to separate the parents and the kids. Mm-hmm. So there's kind of an interesting theme. Right. I mean, a modern one too.
But there's also, I mean, there are sort of already psychological barriers. And again, this is maybe a lot of these horror kind of things are catharsis for the viewers. I'll just tangent real quick. So if you guys have ever seen the movie Matinee with John Goodman, it's about like
a great movie.
It's about like
set in the Key West.
Yeah, the Keys in the 50s during the Cuban Missile Crisis or the 60s. So basically, he's like a movie promoter slash maker.
Yeah,
and he's the guy who makes the like them kind of movies, like Giant Ants and
Super B movies that are sensationalized. Right.
And he'll have like with Spookovision, where you know the chairs are shocking you, and there's like ghosts that fly through on lines, and. He has this one monologue that sort of sums it all up for me for like horror movies is the whole point of the horror movie is to make the person afraid for their life and make everything seem terrible. Even up to the end, it can end poorly. But then when they step out of the theater, they're alive.
Yeah.
They've made it. Like it's like, you know, his whole thing is equating it to like cavemen walking through a cave with torchlight and these drawings. It's sort of at a certain point you come out on the other side and you're in the light and that's the end of it. But I guess with a lot of these movies, we're kind of seeing there's also this catharsis of you're seeing characters who have psychological issues and like family issues. Like you have a girl who is being taken care of, but there's a little bit of like animosity, and you have a mother who's a stepmother, and there's these divides, and the process of fighting the supernatural evil with no rules, which the little dwarf woman with a squeaky voice is the only one who seems to know the answers out of nowhere. Outside in, inside out.
Tangina Barons.
Turn it back around and give yourself a shout. And that's how they save it. Outside in, of course. Tangina.
Is she in the other movies?
She is. She's in all of them.
Okay.
That sort of catharsis stuff, you see that a lot. It's like in the Veldt too, they're talking, it's not solved, but it's the psychology of the split is present, and this thing is testing that. It's putting that through its paces.
Testing the relationships.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So let's round table. Was it scary?
Well, I didn't see this as a kid. I only just saw this this past week. So it wasn't scary to me.
What's the last like scary movie? The Ring.
I don't watch a lot of horror movies though, and
The Ring is truly frightening.
The Ring did kind of spook me.
Yeah.
But I can't imagine many movies spooking me. I'm easily frightened, but not from movies.
Did you see any of the everybody hates on M. Night Shyamalan, for good reasons. But did you see Signs or
I saw Signs.
The Village?
I didn't see The Village.
I kind of want to see The Village still, but yeah.
You haven't seen The Village?
No.
It's worth seeing. It's all right. In both of those movies, he does these, filmmaking-wise, does these tricks that I feel like they do a little bit in this movie, in that they just give you a glimpse of something, just passing. And in Signs, you can see it in that you're seeing the news, and it's like some birthday party or something, and suddenly just this alien walks by, and it's just like so subtle, so quick.
Yeah.
And
that's the best scene of that whole movie.
Absolutely, yeah. And I think that's what this movie does really well, in that you think you're supposed to be watching Carol Ann running through the hallway, but then suddenly you just see this man walking in the mirror real slow or something like that. Just those things. I just think they're somewhat chill-inducing to me anyway. But
yeah, it definitely would have spooked me a lot as if I'd seen it when I was younger. One of my common fears was looking in like a dark window that didn't have a curtain drawn and seeing like a bad man outside or something like that. So I think this would have totally tweaked that kind of thing in me.
But, what about you, Giaco? This is scary.
It had spooks in it a lot. And it may not have scared me, but I was, like I said, really, really impressed. I just recently saw a new horror movie. I try to keep up to date with stuff. And so I just saw Insidious 2 in the theaters. And this movie, I can say here publicly, in a public forum, Poltergeist 3 blows Insidious 2 out of the water. It's just like, this may not be a perfect movie, and I think Insidious 2 and movies like that try to be very, like, taut and scary, and it's constantly scary, and it's supposed to be perfect and well shot. But it has, those movies have no personality. I can't tell you really what that movie was about or how it made me feel, but I can talk a lot about how Poltergeist 3 made me feel, honestly. And this just has such a very vibrant, very specific personality. It knows what it is, it knows what it can do, and it looks like everyone's sort of having a good time as well. So yeah.
It makes me wonder, you know, speaking of, you know, I just said there was kind of a new wave of horror movies that I mentioned, Ju-on and right. The Ring and what is it, Supernatural,
Paranormal Activity,
all these movies. But you know what? They don't have little kids in them. You know, it makes
it
me
depends.
Wonder.
Well, like The Ring had a kid.
Yeah, but he wasn't an integral part of the. He wasn't trying to be sucked into the well or anything like that.
Isn't
being,
the girl?
But I think he was. He was in mortal peril. Like that's something too. We kind of touched on this a little bit. Is that we don't have children of ourselves, and so like you were kind of noting that when we were younger, you equate yourself with the child, and now that we're older, we're supposed to maybe equate ourselves with the parent and be more frightened. But yeah, The Ring had a kid, but I think like that movie was probably marketed to an older, slightly older audience.
Yeah.
Right. The trend in horror movies right now, like 2013, is to be stone-faced, to be like, this is a scary story. You will watch it. You will scream, you know, you will like hold your girlfriend's hand tight, and we're not going to be self like referential. We're going to be very serious about it. This is a
no holds barred.
And also don't you dare like giggle during this movie, you know?
And you can even tell that in the advertising of it, where a lot of the advertising of these new horror movies, they show like clips of the audience watching.
Screaming. Yeah. I know. It's like, that's half of
there's like three movies that I've seen advertised in the last couple of years, and they all show like audiences everywhere. I've been like,
and it's like night vision of a crowd. Yeah, like
exactly.
Screaming
their
guts out. And that's kind of going back to like the Woolsey, like horror kind of thing. It's like those, you know, it's like people in an audience, it's equivalent of having them sign a waiver before they go in because of their heart condition. It's sort of saying like, you better not wet the seats kind of thing. That's showmanship to some degree, like pumping up your own expectations and how you should feel going into it.
Wow. I can't believe you remembered Woolsey. That's great. That's from the movie.
Yeah. I guess the one thing too, you kind of see in these is, I guess that's why like Cabin in the Woods is sort of a fresh,
exactly.
Like it's a breath of fresh air. We shouldn't talk too much about it. Then you should really watch it. I'd say it's on par with your like Evil Dead 2 kind of.
Evil Dead 2 was a little.
It's a little more
like in a way.
It was a little goofier. The Evil Dead 2, but it still has like some horrific things that happen. I mean, it's all personality, and the horror movie is sort of what it's troping on. I'd say Cabin in the Woods, you should watch it. It is definitely playing with genre, and it's self-aware.
Everyone has said that I should see it.
It's super meta.
Yeah,
it's great. It's definitely worth
that
watching.
Definitely sorry.
Yeah, it's like M.C. Escher's Stairs. That's kind of in the posters of this movie.
Cabin in the Woods.
Yeah, they have this weird like Escher-esque thing where the top's the bottom,
like
the bottom's
it's
the top,
and tessellated or whatever.
Yeah,
a little. I think that like there's this whole like. It's definitely Cabin in the Woods is definitely right away with the title setting up your expectations to play with them, and that's what makes that movie fantastic. And one of the other picks we have for this topic kind of has some parallels to that, I think, in not maybe not the twist, but the way the ending is and all that stuff that I don't know. I won't go too much into it. I don't want to break anything or spoil anything for you. I think that's definitely one to catch. Is Cabin in the Woods.
Yeah. Is definitely an exception to the rule of current horror.
So I, I don't know, Poltergeist 3, I think if I was
had
younger...
Had you seen this when you were a kid, or was this one of the first times
seen,
you'd seen
I'd it? I'd watched 1 and 2, I'd seen clips of this, I don't think I'd watched it through. It was a little... I mean, for nowadays, again, personality-wise, I agree, it was like to the nines. It was fun to watch. I liked that the practical gags weren't super gory. Almost no blood in this movie for being a horror movie. And there are some like...
Well, I think they were probably keeping the rating down.
Yeah. There are some creepy stuff in it. And again, one of my notes is the sort of... There's a point where Tangerina gets turned into like this wax monster dead girl. And Laura Flynn Boyle bursts out of her. Like rips out.
So frightening.
So weird. Shocking. So fast and cool. It's sort of the, you know, one of those quick, crazy moments where you're just like, this character's dead. This girl's bursting out of her out of nowhere. But no blood. Like, you kind of have this weird wax zombie mummy thing. And just, ugh. It was tactile and creepy and more sort of... It gave me sort of a surreal sort of like, ugh. Like, how would that feel? Question mark. Versus watching, like, a modern, like, torture porn kind of thing. Right. Like, I'd almost rather, if I'm going to have blood, I prefer to have kind of goofier blood, usually, than, like, full-out, like, Saw-style torture porn blood. Like, I'd rather have buckets of blood and fake sausage intestines. Right. Just because, like, I can get it. I just don't, that's not the kind of, like, feeling.
Well, I mean, if it's, you know, I love a good bloody horror movie as long as it's not just that. You know what I mean? For instance, if this movie had a bunch of blood in it of like, you know, people getting cut with mirrors or whatever, if it fit in the movie well, I'd be fine with it. Right. You know what I mean? I just don't like it when it's just like, well, what makes this movie scary? Well, they're cutting people's fingers off and sticking them up people's noses. You know what I mean? None of that stuff really does it for me.
That's pretty scary.
Yeah, man. It is.
Well, I guess what I mean is
the
that
picker.
There's for being a very brightly lit movie, there's a lot of unknown and unease.
Yeah.
And that's what I look for in my stories, is sort of not knowing what the boundaries of the monster are and not knowing who the monster really is. And I don't know. There's a creep factor, and I enjoyed that. And I like the all in bright daylight, but really well handled.
Yeah, I think if you're into filmmaking too, it's an interesting one to watch, just to see that, because, you know, there are no digital effects in this movie. It's all practical. You know, and it's neat in that it's using kind of old, there are a lot of old magician kind of illusionist tricks with the mirrors and stuff. It's good for that reason too. I think is a study.
The one big strike against it, which was completely unnecessary, was the very end. They just have lightning strike the building and the laughter. It's sort of like we just had a very clean wrap up. Yeah. Everything was pretty like straightforward.
Was that the Sears Tower?
The end.
Yeah, it was like the end of Thriller.
Yeah.
Was that the Sears Tower?
I don't know. I mean, it's somewhere in Chicago. I don't know what the building was.
No.
I don't honestly know. I mean, it could very well have been that for that last established.
Yeah, that
shot,
last shot.
Could have been.
Because that was supposed to be the building they were in, right?
Right.
Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, they were supposed to be living in the Sears Tower?
It was like a brand new building that he had just like built. But the one they were using as the exterior, I don't know when the Sears Tower was erected, so...
No, it was before 1988.
Hmm.
But this was directed by Gary Sherman. I guess I should have mentioned that. It came out in 88.
Yeah. Was it produced by Spielberg?
You know, I didn't see him mentioned as being... I know that Gary Sherman was a co-producer and a co-writer in this as well, but I don't think Spielberg was... If he might have been an executive producer.
Maybe Amblin had a hand in it or something. Which would have kind of put it under his umbrella anyways. All right. Well, this was a great pick, Keith.
Yes, I think according to Wikipedia, for the John Hancock Center, it was featured in Poltergeist.
Oh, the John Hancock Center?
Well, it's the Sears Tower / John Hancock
Center. Cool.
Okay.
Well, there you go.
The Sears Tower was also featured in Mom and Dad Save the Universe, Save the World. In a really funny scene.
Carol Ann.
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 Carol Ann. Carol Ann.
Carol Ann.
Carol Ann.
Carol Ann.
Carol Ann.
Carol Ann.
Carol Ann.
Carol Ann.
Carol Ann.
Carol Ann?
Carol Ann? Carol Ann? Carol Ann? Carol Ann, come to Carol Ann. Please, Carol Ann. Carol Ann? Carol Ann? Hey, Carol Ann, join us, Carol Ann.
Carol Ann! Carol Ann! Carol Ann! Carol drowning! She's drowning!
Where? Where?
Carol Ann!
Donna.
Carol Ann!
You're safe now.
Carol Ann!
Where?
Carol Ann!
Where is she? Darling.
She's drowning! What is it?
Such a question. There are many possible answers, such as hard work.
Here's the goal. Here's the goal.
Feel I'm alone in this hole of existence. I know it takes time, but I'm losing my persistence. The distance is too far to fetch, so I sketch on pages and hope that some catch the thoughts of my inverted worded music. No trial or error, just emotion when I do this focus.
Hey everybody, thanks for listening to this first installment of the new
Scary
Show's
Spooky.
Scary and Spooky.
Welcome to John Holt's Spooky Theater.
I would go to that theater.
Blah, blah,
blah, blah.
Children, come to me. Bring your candy.
Do you have any pens?
Come into my van. Blah,
I love to count children. 2 children. 10 children. Yes. So the scariness this week was The Veldt by Ray Bradbury from 1950, Saturday Evening Post, and Poltergeist from 1988. So I was one of your hosts this week, John Holt. You can find me on Twitter at Lord Joho. Also with me this week,
I'm Mary Varn. You can find me on Twitter at Mary Varn.
And Mary does a comic.
Yes, I do. NPCcomic.com.
All right. And Giaco, where can people find you?
You can find me at Fearnet, on fearnet.com for my weekly articles. And you can find me on Twitter at Giaco Furino.
All right.
And I'm one of your other hosts, Keith Vincent. And you can find me on Tumblr, earthlingkeith.tumblr.com, or just earthlingkeith.com works too. I got that website too.
So if you'd like to leave any comments, we have comments on our Tumblr, the newtoyoushow.com. We also will be posting show notes there, along with some pictures and a little bit about the content that we're talking about on our shows. You can join us next week when we pick up a couple more picks
of more scary stuff.
Scary. So we'll continue our theme of that, and we will once again be joined by Giaco, Keith, Mary, and myself.
Yay!
We'll be joined by ourselves.
Yeah,
and a poltergeist.
You feel free to leave us a review, good or bad, on iTunes, and you can subscribe to us on iTunes as well. And if you would like to follow us on Twitter, it is at newtoyoushow.com. I think. No, it's not. It's at newtoyoushow. That's right. That's what new Twitter is. Because you don't do .com for Twitter.
No.
All right.
But newtoyoushow.com is where you find the podcast.
Yes.
So why did we start recording this on an ancient Indian burial ground?
Well, the cats said it was a good idea, and I had just buried them there like moments before.
Well, we are recording in Park Slope, which is where a revolutionary battle occurred.
Oh, really?
So.
And we're doing it by candlelight.
Caroline.
Caroline. Eat your tangerinas.
Don't go towards the light. It's cold. Tangerina says it's cold.
Anyway, see y'all next week.
All right. If it hoped, let's see. It may not have been new
to you,
but hopefully it
maybe
was new
it's
to
new to you.
Blarg.
This pitiful life is all about the music.
We will end together forever. Without the limitation of time, ever again. So the second coming of the Lord is not the Lord. They're two separate.